try this again. All right, we are live.
Awesome. Thank you, Jeffrey. Good morning from Edmonton, Canada. Welcome to the panel on the liminal spaces of punishment. My name is Denis Tokwe-Oriola, chair of this morning's panel and faculty member in the Center for Criminological Research, Department of Sociology, University of Alberta. Before we begin, I would like to acknowledge that University of Alberta, the place from which this conference is hosted, is on Treaty 6 territory, a traditional meeting ground, gathering place, and traveling route to the Cree, Soto, Blackfoot, Métis, Dene, and Nakota Sioux. We acknowledge all the many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit, whose footsteps have marked these lands for centuries. We acknowledge their enormous sacrifices and ongoing quest for a fairer and more equitable society. Welcome. For those joining us by YouTube, kindly type your questions to our panelists as we go on. And as you can see, we have an outstanding lineup of presenters. As previously told to the presenters, each presenter will speak for approximately 20 minutes. They've all agreed to stick with that timeline. And that gives us 20 to 25 minutes or thereabout for the Q&A session. We have outstanding grad students who are monitoring comments from YouTube, and they will bring those comments to my attention so we can post them to our panelists. Thanks to hardworking grad students and of course, Jeffrey Bassad from the CCR for his expertise and hard work in the course of this year's conference. Okay, so we have all the way from the City University of New York, Carla Shedd. The title of Carla's presentation is When Protection and Punishment Collide, New York City's Juvenile Court System and the Carceral Continuum. After Carla, we would have Phil Goodman and Katie Quinn, all the way from the University of Toronto. And they will be speaking on Becoming Ideal, Organizational Variation and Penal Subject. Final presentation for this morning session would be Megan Comfort and Keeonna Harris, all the way from RTI International. And they will be speaking on Exacerbating Inequity, Implications of the COVID-19 Pandemic for Families with Incarcerated Loved Ones in the United States. And if Carla is ready, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to share my screen and move to, let's see, PowerPoint. I would like to thank the organizers of this conference for inviting me. It's amazing to sort of cross these boundaries of place to connect around work that's so important, and I appreciate being on this panel with these amazing people. I also want to thank the University of Alberta for educating my dissertation chair, John Hagen, and sending him over to us, where I learned so much from him at Northwestern. So I've always wanted to give that acknowledgement to the University of Alberta. So today I will share a bit about my book in progress on New York City's juvenile court. I would like to talk about my empirical approach to tracking the carceral continuum, a concept that Foucault and then Loic Bacon has picked up on theoretically, but I want to think about it empirically, how we understand these transitions and turning points on people's trajectories in their interactions with the criminal justice system. I want to speak specifically about schools as institutions of promise and punishment that builds on my prior work studying Chicago public schools and then moving to New York City to examine some of those same themes in a different place. I always want to connect the institutions that touch people's lives, so I'll talk a bit about that and move on to a sketch of my findings and thoughts about how we might move forward. In order to study criminal justice, I really want to think critically about justice as an empirical concept. And when sitting down and designing the New York City arm of this research, you know, nearly 6 years ago, I thought, okay, people are studying the criminal justice system. I've been studying perceptions of injustice, thinking about the gap between one's expectations of a system and their actual assessment of their experiences. And so how do we push this further to really make it concrete what the measurable attributes of justice are? And that's an acknowledgement in criminology where we have the BJS reports and we think about these snapshots of the justice process, but oftentimes they are very, very separate and they don't give a comprehensive overview of what's happening. So to think of the measurable attributes, we will go from as far as young people contacting the system by being told to move on or being told to move off the street, being stopped and searched, to actual arrest and incarceration toward the end of the system. I also wanted to think about the relational dimensions of justice, and procedural justice is really also based on this comparison that one could make across their experience and that of other individuals, but also groups. And so moving this to the context of young people's perceptions of injustice and their relational assessments of it was something that was not done too often because we concentrated on adults and what they thought of their system contacts. But young people were having contacts that weren't necessarily being documented, and they were thinking about it, and it was happening in a formative stage of not only their life trajectories, but also their behaviors and their attitudes and how they thought of themselves. So I really center adolescents in this work as I think about the impacts of these very key moments in shaping their understandings of how they're treated in comparison to others. And schools will change that context. If you move from one school to another school, you might be surrounded by different people, or perhaps it may be homogenous and you see some continuity in your experience and someone else's. And I think the relational piece is even more intense now as we think about the media attention on justice, particularly after the recent, protests and marches and this movement for Black lives in particular. I also want to think about justice with a distributive format and how we mete out justice and understanding that from the courtrooms as well as our sort of public engagement with this idea of what justice means. And for some people, justice means you arrest the people who did something wrong. For others, it means that you change systems. And so we really have to interrogate these concepts deeply to talk about clearly what we're asking for and what a shared understanding might be for the distribution of justice. The procedural elements, again, how justice is given, one's understanding of their context, and then the concrete process. So I've gone through this list and I, especially focus on justice as an outcome, but there are so many ways that lead up to it and our understandings of it. So I will give a little bit more about my kind of approach to this, but I just wanted to lay out those broad parameters as we think about this concept. Now for this particular project in New York City, it began after I was, revising the book about Chicago, but also looking for an extension of my work here. And I was tapped by the Legal Aid Society and they said, we have lawyers going into court and they're defending their clients, person by person, but we don't have a comprehensive overview of who these people are, what they're coming from, what their experiences are. And all we can do is kind of calculate what our losses or wins are for their particular case, but what does this mean for the system? And, I had to do a lot of different tweaks to my approach because I couldn't rely on their administrative data because that doesn't tell you the full social knowledge and base of what is happening. I also, had to get access to the courtrooms and to be in those rooms where you have a calendar that may not match the reality of what happens. You have judges who may come in and leave in the next moment and, you know, there's just dead space. But I was lucky enough at my prior institution, Columbia, to design a class around capturing what was happening with the juvenile courtroom as the unit of analysis and going in and sort of just being there as systematic observers of the process. And so I want to give a little bit of a summary in light of what that means. So this quote is from James Baldwin. He says, "For these are all our children. We will all profit by or pay for what they become." So if you were to sit in those courtrooms, as I did with a team of student researchers for approximately a year, you would see justice in action. And perhaps you would wonder, is this truly what democracy and justice looks like? You would witness who we call Respondent 89 in three court appearances over 3 months, an 11-year-old contending with the double-edged sword of youthfulness in the assessment of his behavior. He has endured unspeakable trauma and is reportedly influenced by people in his home and community. This boy will only get access to the mental health services he so desperately needs because he is court involved. You would see Respondent 102, a transgender girl who was observed 5 times over 4 months, who had gone AWOL numerous occasions from her close to home, unlocked detention facility. She violated the order of her assigned judge. Yes, the same judge who clumsily tries to remember the correct pronouns, but at least they try, and their preferred name when addressing 102 in court. She violated that order by running back into her community whenever she could because she feels safer on the street. You would also hear the grandfather of Respondent 27, surrendering his rights as the 13-year-old's primary guardian by requesting, quote, "Your Honor, I want him to be put away so he can get treatment. Either the drugs or the streets are gonna kill him," end quote. I argue that these are the grandchildren of Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow population. These are the legacy of mass incarceration. What will become of these young people? How can we document this next iteration of the carceral state? And so I based this work in New York City to capture these social narratives that are deployed in the courtroom and the ways that the legal considers the social as they mete out punishment. I aim for this work to open a door to the usually hidden world of this central, formative, and reformative social institution. Going beyond common snapshots of juvenile justice administration that are depicted in statistics on youth arrest, prosecution, detention, or secure correctional facility placement, where the yearly cost to operate one bed is up to $200,000 in New York, I aim to present a nuanced picture of how this trusted and powerful institution can simultaneously protect and harm those dependent upon it for their safety and well-being. The study is a multi-stage empirical exploration of the juvenile court process conducted during a period in which three critical social and political processes are underway. One, we're at the end of juvenile decarceration efforts. Over 20 juvenile detention facilities have been closed in New York State since 2008. We have been in the midst of the close to home initiatives where there have been expanded community-based alternatives to incarceration programs and witnessing in real time judges' assessments of especially the new programs. And again, them deciding, I don't know who those people are running that program. I'm actually more comfortable putting the kid in the lockup that I know and where we've sent them. So you can have these new programs on the books, but who is using them and how do we know the sort of assessments that are done? And three, we have the Raise the Age campaigns that have increased the age of criminal responsibility in New York City from 16, you were an adult at 16 when I started this research, to now 18 as of last October 2019. So this is all very new. These changing policies are then reflected on what's happening in the legal sphere. And so when I think about a carceral continuum, it doesn't necessarily start in the courtroom. It begins in neighborhoods where here you can see this jail playground I often show when I give talks that was on the grounds of the Tompkins projects in Brooklyn for 6 years until about 2010, when there was an uproar about this photo going to the mainstream and people couldn't believe there was this beautiful playground apparatus that depicted jail sitting in the middle of a neighborhood where there were disparate numbers of people actually going to prison. So none of this is abstract for the young people who would be playing on that structure. And it says a lot about our assessments of how we think of children's play and what we would give young people dependent on the place where they lived and their race and their class. So this is reflective for me of tracing these carceral apparatuses as we move across space. And I've documented, you know, for purposes of my work, where we have placed these panopticons to build on this carceral continuum and the very Foucauldian approach. But where are these towers placed? They might be between housing projects. They're in the midst of a gang war, as it may be typed in the media. It may be down on Canal Street to deal with crowds and shopping and different times, or it may be in Harlem in the aftermath of a shooting that happened, just to sort of signify a presence of the police. And we have these extensions, not just the towers, but they move to the police presence and how we move forward. So these are just the arcs of inquiry I want to bring into my unconventional criminological approach to studying justice and understanding the role of the state. So in tracking the carceral continuum, I argue that we have moved from, and me and my research in particular, from studying the neighborhoods that may shape crime behaviors, so then thinking about the assessments of the same in the judicial arena. And what my study brings to the fore is how we are not assessing people by their, the sort of justice holistic look at one case and an individual and a holistic approach to understanding them. But I have patterns documented through the ethnography of young people who are told, okay, I don't want to send you back to Harlem where you're likely to be arrested again, so I can lock you up. Studying justice, noting the courtroom and how the tone and emotion shift when a child is brought in from the waiting room and the double doors that everyone, you know, the lawyers and the spectators or family members can walk into. But when they have to leave and are detained in handcuffs and put in the lockup, and you see the choreography of the court change, and the court officers have to line up, the mother has to ask, can she hug her child? And so all of these things cannot be captured in conventional measures, but we can note the tone, we can note the shifts, and we can understand a little bit more about how these structures have bent to deal with these changes. And one sort of last snapshot, I put my timer on for sure. So I wanted to, you know, even capture at this discrete stage of the process. So detainment before the trial is really important, and it really changes trajectories of young people's punishment. And I have comparisons across judges for the same offenses. I can think about differences across cases for the same judge. So these nested comparisons are important. But just as a generalized snapshot, I also wanted to think of the rationales that judges use when they made a decision to place a kid or you know, let them out at the stage after going through the court process. So after the hearing, as it's called in juvenile court, and noting in a neutral way what the rationales were. So I could have guardian control there. And as an aggravating circumstance, the judge would say, you're not listening to your mother. I can't send you home with her. But as a mitigating circumstance, they would say, wow, you know, your mom's come in and giving you, you know, really wonderful reports, and I'm proud of you and what you've done. And so I take that and see how they list them and prioritize them to think about how this relates to the outcome. And so some of the kind of pieces that come up, because we are doing this in a very inductive way, where school attendance comes in and other ways that institutions that the judge themselves can't necessarily control, but we know school attendance would also be shaped by the kids showing up to these hearings, where we could document perhaps as little as 2 minutes on the record, but we know the staging that had to happen, you know, would be hours for the parent to show up in the waiting room and be told they could come into the court to be on the docket, as well as the kid who had to come from their detention facility and wait in the back in the holding room and be brought out, all for a documented 2 minutes. And so on the instrument to note the time and to think about a judge saying, you didn't comply with my order to attend school and I see your truancy rates. So I'm now going to make sure that I have control over that. And the other sort of features of compliance being measured by how young people can navigate the city itself, you know. So if you don't go to this program, even though it's 3 trains away, you have ADHD, can't necessarily get there, and I see a violation because you carried a box cutter to go to that new neighborhood. Like, these are the sort of details that I want to bring up as we assess young people's outcomes. And so to sort of wrap up, as we think about criminal justice reform and the changes that are made, we cannot simply keep painting over these surface level approaches. And even with these huge programmatic shifts, you know, close to home, people thought, oh, we're going to bring the kids to the neighborhood. And they really didn't account for kids going AWOL. I mean, it was amazing to kind of watch that process in real time. And now to think that the family court has jurisdiction over 16-year-olds and 17-year-olds who commit you know, much more serious crimes, and to note that there will be a change in the pool of offenses that are dealt with, I think that should be worrisome. It also made me not want to just go back in and keep documenting what was happening, because I feel like we know what's happening. Now, what are we going to do? And I'm at the stage of the what are we going to do process. And that's, you know, sort of helping me to kind of step away from writing this up, but really giving some light to the next projects and what it might mean to shore up the pro-social institutions that will be important to stemming flows onto the carceral continuum in the first place. So thank you for listening, and I'm excited to hear my other panelists as we move forward. And I will stop sharing, I hope, and go forward. I look forward to your questions.
All right. Thank you very much, Carla, for that fascinating presentation. I'm very sure we'd have a lot of interesting questions and comments about your work and the broader socioeconomic, political, and cultural environment within the U.S., but particularly the city of New York, which you was currently studying, and your previous work on the city of Chicago as this sort of miniature crucibles for all kinds of social problems very early in childhood. Next up, we have Phil Goodman and Katie Quinn, all the way from the U of T, and they will be speaking on Becoming Ideal, Organizational Aviation, and the penal subject. Kim.
Okay, thank you. I'll just share my screen really quickly. All right, great. Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming. Thank you for watching. And thank you to Sandra for the invitation, and to all of the conference organizers and volunteers for all of your efforts for this wonderful event. I'll talk for about 10 minutes and then I'll hand it over to Phil, my co-author and colleague, for the second half of our presentation. So our paper examines nonprofit organizations or NGOs that offer programs and services to criminalized individuals. And these organizations are sometimes collectively referred to as the penal voluntary sector, or the PVS for short. And we adopt this terminology in our paper as a kind of umbrella category so that we can talk about a variety of services and spaces, including things like prison ministries, halfway houses, addictions counseling, employment agencies, amongst other roles and tasks undertaken by NGO-led reentry agencies and their staff. In recent years, scholars have made the case for the rising importance of these types of organizations in the penal field, pointing to large-scale economic, social, and policy changes that have positioned PVS organizations as core players in a mixed economy of social and penal service delivery in countries around the world. The PVS as a concept encompasses a huge diversity of organizations, programs, and helping ideologies. So for example, last night, Katarina Mayer described some of the different ways that Halfway House staff understood their roles in prisoner reentry and their relationships to the criminal justice system and its actors. Her presentation in particular served to illustrate the broader point that though PVS organizations and their staff are similarly oriented towards prisoner reentry, they employ a range of tactics, practices, and relationships as they engage in this work. So what is less often investigated, however, is how the inter and intra-organizational differences that scholars have described impact criminalized individuals as clients of these organizations. Now, alongside this is a curious feature of much of the reentry and desistance literatures. PVS organizations are often used by researchers to gain access to criminalized individuals as a hard-to-reach population, but these choices are more frequently thought of as methodological rather than analytical. And as a result, we don't know that much about the relationship between these sites of recruitment and the stories or narratives that we end up collecting. So, and in response and with this paper, we ask, how do criminalized people think about themselves and their reentry vis-a-vis the specific PVS organizations from which they choose or are ordered to seek services? To answer this question, we rely on 44 interviews conducted with criminalized men and women in the Greater Toronto Area of Ontario, Canada, who are accessing services at one of four PVS organizations. We also examined these organizations' websites and public documents. We coded our interview data in two ways that are important to quickly talk about in order to understand the interpretations that we're making today. So first, we coded them inductively to generate this list of core themes about how participants understood or approached their reentry. And second, we used this scale to assess how relevant or important each of these themes was for each participant's reentry narrative. And now I think it's worth noting that though strictly speaking, we do engage in some quantification of our data here, we do so only as a tool to guide our thinking about organizational differences and for data visualization. So this figure reports the modal or typical results of this coding process, separating participants according to the PVS organization where they were seeking resettlement services. And these labels are pseudonyms. The goal here was to get a sense of the kinds of reentry narratives that were typical for clients of each organization. And as we hope is immediately evident, there are some considerable differences. In the remainder of the presentation, we will detail some of these key differences to demonstrate that criminalized individuals' visions of themselves, their journeys into and out of crime, as well as their hopes and expectations for the future, were clustered according to and notably aligning with the ethos of the particular PVS organizations where they were receiving services. Our first organization is Liam House, and this is a halfway house for criminalized men, many of whom were sent there by Correctional Service Canada. Clients here tended to be managing, and this is a quote from the organization, significant mental illness and addiction, as well as other chronic or complex medical needs. And programs at Liam House are guided by the leisure education content model, which recognizes the importance of recreation in changing knowledge, skills, and attitudes, which together are thought to work towards changing behavior. So practically speaking, this means that the priority is placed on things like self-care, nutrition and exercise, communication, and leadership. And most important to understand is that this is an indirect route to rehabilitation that prioritizes process over outcomes. For residents of Liam House, the pacing of their reentry was one of the most important features of how they talked about their lives after prison. They described that this organization expected them to make slow, steady progress towards some combination of independent living, sobriety, and stable health. They were told not to get too far ahead of themselves in the process. For example, not to apply to too many jobs or too soon after their release. Amongst Liam House staff and residents, there was a shared sense that successful reentry was to unfold slowly. Most described living at the halfway house and their plans for the future as being explicitly different from before they went to prison, when they lived the so-called fast life. More so than any of our other participants, residents of Liam House sought to distance themselves from their old life and move on to a new and, in their own assessment, more stable direction. Our second organization is called Cornerstone, and this is a large national organization with regional offices. It's primarily funded by the government, including service delivery contracts with Correctional Service Canada. Its clients are criminalized men, many of whom are mandated to seek services, particularly anger management, with referrals from the courts, employers, and government assistance programs. And programming at Cornerstone is explicitly outcome-driven, solution-oriented, and designed specifically to keep people out of jail. So a big contrast here with the processual model at Liam House. Cornerstone participants shared the perspective that the criminal justice system and society more broadly were fundamentally unfair. They gave examples of being repeatedly harassed by police, instances where police behaved illegally, or just generally believing that the nature of their charges were unwarranted or bogus was a word that a lot of participants used to describe this. And now this was in stark contrast to participants from the other organizations who often ultimately came around to framing their incarceration in a positive light as serving to improve their self-understandings and perhaps even their lives. Another theme amongst Cornerstone participants is what we've coded here as inertia. So participants recounted feeling stuck, hopeless, or unable to move forward. And under this logic, participants spoke of just needing something or really anything to go their way to get things rolling in the right direction or to get some momentum in their life. So one participant expressed that he had no goals, not even to stay alive, but that this could all be turned around if he received government grant funding to undertake new job training. More broadly, Cornerstone participants often found it difficult to be optimistic about the services being offered to them. They were the least satisfied, and by some stretch, of those we interviewed, and many characterized this organization as covertly punitive. For example, Jack claims, "I feel that it's just very soft control. Basically, they're lumping all these people together, myself included, and trying to tell us what's the right way to behave, what's the right thoughts to have, what's acceptable, you know? And it's kind of belittling people. It's not a prison, but yet all these agencies, I feel like there's this prison mentality established in them to control people and modify their behavior." Jack's critique here is interesting for two reasons. First, it powerfully articulates a theme common across much of the recent punishment in society literature. Agencies that position themselves as helping criminalized individuals nonetheless frequently reproduce damaging discourses of their clients as risky or broken, just as prisons and jails do. And they employ practices that are hauntingly similar to those found in many penal institutions. And second, while this view of PVS organizations as part of a larger continuum of care slash control was common amongst Cornerstone participants, it was nearly absent in our wider sample. So critiques like Jack's stand in stark contrast to the modal or typical positivity of those from the other three organizations who tended to describe them as fundamentally unlike the prisons and jails that they experienced as trying to control or punish them. I'll now just hand over control to Phil.
Wonderful, and thank you. Okay, so turning now to Justice for Women, or J4W. J4W is the regional chapter of one of the many PBS, one of the major, pardon me, PBS players in Canada. J4W offers services to women, as it's constructed, who are, as they construct their clients, women who are criminally involved. In this case, women who have experienced some combination of arrest, detention, or incarceration. So the vast majority then of their clients have a formal criminal record, and this will stay with them for years to come. In addition to providing services directly to clients, J4W as a whole, as well as each of its regional chapters, advocates for criminal justice reform, especially equity in terms of women's access to programs, resources, and so forth. Politically, commentators often describe J4W as mildly or softly left of center, and as an organization working in close collaboration with federal and provincial government, from which the vast majority of J4W's funding is derived. According to J4W's mantra as an outward-facing framing, its women clients got involved in crime because they made poor decisions. Drawing on and adapting sociological ideas about structure and inequality, these mistakes are described as patterned and therefore ultimately forgivable. Clients then, according to J4W, are not bad people. They often indeed contrast their clients against criminally justice-involved men who are sometimes portrayed in their discourses and wider discourses as dangerous, violent, and risky. Instead, women clients at J4W are cast as vulnerable, disempowered, and victims of an unequal society. And therefore, the organization says, what they need most is emotional growth. So while it may be tempting as critical scholars to see this focus on emotional growth as something like vapid, that would be a mistake if we therefore assume it's content and work free. Indeed, a lot happens at J4W. It may not often result in living wage jobs or stable housing. However, clients at J4W do engage in serious identity work, and it shapes, as we'll see, how they see their past, presents, and futures. The consequences then are very real. Clients at J4W describe themselves, in keeping with many of the organization's key framings, as having made bad choices and mistakes. Joanne, for instance, articulates that even good people make mistakes. In keeping again with the organizational framing, she also distinguishes herself from people who commit murder or certain types of theft. This articulation by Joanne and others we interviewed at J4W, again, it does a lot of work. For one thing, it helps to bond or connect clients to program staff, who also overwhelmingly identify as women. Together, they see clients as good people who have strayed and need help. In addition, the alignment between criminalized women, staff, and the program helps justify an approach that focuses on equity and resources, long-term intensive involvement in the program, and the need for an entire suite of programming that focuses on everything from interpersonal skills to building self-confidence to possessing the appropriate clothes to wear to interviews. As an example of seeing and constructing clients as good people who need help, those we interviewed from J4W commonly noted the need for inner self-improvement. Venus, for example, told us that her biggest problem was self-confidence and her need to take stock of both who she really is and how she reacts and deals with others. So to pivot now to our fourth and final organization, consider in-service. In-service is what sociologist Nicole Kaufman calls a religiously inspired organization, unlike the other three from which we recruited that are secular. Other differences are its size. In-service is by a fair margin the smallest of the organizations that we recruited participants from. And that's whether measured by staff, budget, or the flow of clients through the program. In-service draws almost all of its clients from a particular provincial jail for men. And that jail is considered by many in-service participants, as well as commentators, as the province's only real treatment facility. And the majority of people incarcerated at the jail, it's worth noting, are convicted of either a sexual offense or less commonly, but also of some numbers, of a drug offense. This jail performs a type of treatment, as does in-service, that focuses heavily on confessional storytelling. It's not entirely unlike the one, the approach one sometimes finds in some AA or NA programming, but in this case, with a major reliance on notions of disgust. That is, people at the jail, and then in-service picks this up once those folks are released and come to the program, are told they must find their past selves disgusting and morally reprehensible. And they're told they must do this in order to create a newer, healthier self moving forward. So while it might be tempting to see in-service in light of all of this is totally different from the other three organizations, it's important to note that the themes that are invoked in interviews have key similarities and differences. For instance, participants often talked about the jail and in-service as providing them turning points. And you may recall from an earlier slide that turning points were scored in an overall 2 or 3 in our data analysis and visualization for each of the other organizations as well. Father Brown provides an example, describing the jail as having saved his life, a role he now sees in-service as providing in what we might think of as a kind of seamless, if perhaps highly problematic, jail to program pipeline. By describing the program as constituting a helpful, indeed often essential intervention, people like Father Brown bolster or align with program level claims that clients can be helped or saved from a life of crime, but only with intense, very long duration services, as they're fighting not just some bad decisions and mistakes, as at J for W, but instead a deeply diseased self, again, using the program's constructions to understand what would constitute a mistake or a deeply diseased self. For many of those we interviewed from in-service, this long-term intervention was best when it took the form of support from others. Danny, for example, spoke about how the staff at in-service took the time to really know the inner workings of his mind, something he contrasted with Cornerstone, from which he had also incidentally sought services in the past. But unlike those we interviewed at Cornerstone, Danny saw this getting inside his mind as good and necessary, a way to ensure he would be saved from slipping into his old self, as he was told, and which he told himself was something to find repulsive. To wrap up now, we want to end now, with some thoughts by way of conclusion. And of course, we very much look forward to questions as a way to delve into these findings further. First, our research demonstrates that organizations matter. Organizations have what Fergus McNeil refers to as editorial power. That is, organizations frame clients in particular ways, and clients in turn use and adapt those frames to shape their own narratives about themselves, their relationships to programs, and their relationships to program staff. We want to be very clear here that we are not saying participants are parrots, but instead that there's a remarkable alignment between programs and clients. And that's because fields shape organizations and organizations shape individuals. To wrap up then, the variation between and across organizations is consequential. It's consequential in terms of how the ideal penal client is framed and articulated. And across each of the four organizations, key and varying assumptions are being made about criminality, rehabilitation, appropriate services, and programming. So we close the paper coming out of this research as well as today's presentation by raising a question. How might these alignments impact resettlement and assistance? Since we know from other research that stories and narratives about the self affect people's presence and futures, how might organizations and organizational variation impact clients' articulations of themselves? Additionally, how might this variation impact what happens to people in the weeks, months, and years after incarceration? Thank you very much.
All right, thank you very much, Phil, and thank you, Katie, for your presentation. I'm sure we would have a lot of questions regarding your research and the variation in different levels of perceptions and experiences that you so articulated. We move on now to Megan Comfort and Keeonna Harris from RTI International. They will be speaking on exacerbating inequity, implications of the COVID-19 pandemic for families with incarcerated loved ones in the United States. I apologize, that was just my timer going up. Okay, one of the insignias of the times. Okay, so over to Megan and Keeonna.
Wonderful, thank you so much. Thank you very much to Sandra Gutierrez and the other organizers for including us in this amazing lineup of speakers for this conference. I am Megan Comfort, and Keeonna Harris and I are really honored and excited to have a chance to join the important conversations that this conference has been pushing forward. It's been a very rich few days, and we're really happy to be here. In our presentation today, I'm going to provide a bit of background regarding the evolution of research about and services for family members of people who are incarcerated. And then Keeonna will draw on her recent research as well as her personal experiences to discuss how the COVID-19 pandemic is exacerbating suffering and inequality. So as framing for everything we're talking about, we want to specifically say that when we are talking about jails and prisons in the United States, we are talking about institutions that massively over-incarcerate Black, Indigenous, and people of color. We certainly imagine that this is not news to anyone participating in this conference, but as Congressperson John Lewis tirelessly reminded all of us, we have a, quote, moral obligation to speak up and speak out, and we want to foreground the people whose lives are most affected by the punishment system. This slide and the next are from a very helpful blog post that went up in July, posted by the Prison Policy Initiative on visualizing racial disparities in mass incarceration. And this figure shows incarceration rates per 100,000 for local jails in the United States. I do want to acknowledge the challenges and issues that come up with racial and ethnic categorization of people and data from the criminal legal system. But using those data nonetheless, we see here that the rates are 592 per 100,000 people in jail for Black people, 401 Indigenous people per 100,000. And then we see that white, non-Hispanic, and Hispanic people are relatively similar in the 180s. As we look at the towering orange bar on this slide to the left, that indicates that 2,272 Black men per 100,000 were in state or federal prisons in 2018. I want to encourage anyone who missed it to listen to Professor Ruben Miller's tour de force presentation at this conference on Tuesday, in which he spoke about the presumption of Black guilt as a child of racial slavery. Again, I imagine these are familiar statistics to everyone, but we need to continue to be shocked by them and to continue to realize that they are not budging in the ways that they need to be. This slide also shows across sex that people who are categorized as other or categorized as Hispanic are imprisoned at higher rates than white people. There are two different scales used on this for people classified as men and as women, so just keep that in mind. Again, we imagine our audience today is well aware of these numbers, but as a part of the conversations that erupted across the United States in the wake of George Floyd's murder, as millions of white Americans started to grapple with the concept of systemic racism, we want to highlight that scholars of incarceration have an opportunity to get into the good trouble of working ever harder to highlight the connections between jails, prisons, the legacy of slavery, and white supremacy. So moving on now to speak about family members of people who are incarcerated. When I was conducting my dissertation fieldwork 20 years ago, focusing on women visiting their male partners who were imprisoned in Northern California, I drew very heavily on these three books to analyze what I was learning. And these are all very good books, but I was drawing on them heavily because they were pretty much all that was available on the topic of people who had loved ones in jails or prisons. So we had seen the steep rise of what we call mass incarceration in the United States, but really the primary area of focus was on the people who were being held behind bars. So the wonderful news is that this is more of the state of the field today. We now have a robust body of research about the experiences of families with incarcerated loved ones. And this slide is by no means exhaustive of all of the amazing work that has been and is being done. You can't contain the riches of the literature now on one slide. At the bottom of the slide, I also included a link to the Global Prisoners Families Research Group, which is based at Oxford University under directors Rachel Condry and Shauna Minson. I just wanted to bring that up as well. There's an effort to unite people who are working in this area across the globe. And so for people who are interested, I encourage you to look at that and to join the network. So the growth of the research has provided us with a nuanced, rigorous, multi-method analytical lens on the experiences of families of prisoners. And the literature now carefully documents that having a loved one in jail or prison is highly likely to cause or contribute to emotional distress, poor health, economic precarity, housing instability, avoidance of civic engagement, and a whole host of other harmful outcomes. While many families are incredibly resilient and some manage to thrive in the face of this adversity, no scholar working in this field has concluded that incarceration is a wise and fruitful strategy for promoting family well-being, and there are direct policy implications of the vast majority of this work. All of which makes it incredibly frustrating that the research is where most of the change has happened over the past 20 years. Despite the direct relevance of the literature to policies, practices, and services, in the United States, we have seen essentially no progress towards systemic change to mitigate the difficulties faced by families affected by incarceration and to address their service needs. There have been incremental efforts here and there, and I don't want to negate the importance of what has been done, the hard work that those changes took. But generally speaking, things have only gotten worse for families. This is my wordiest slide, as you will notice, but when I think about the policy implications of the literature, the words come pouring out. I think also we heard a lot of this resonate in the panels we've had over the last 2 days of people speaking from their own lived experience. So to go through just a few of the many policy implications that jump out at us from this rich body of literature, first and foremost, we see clearly that there's a evidence base to rely much less heavily on punishment and incarceration and to invest much more in community and family resources. The literature strongly supports making staying in frequent touch with family members easier, cheaper, and less traumatic. So both in-person visiting and talking to people on the phone, sending things to each other. There's a clear need to provide mental health support for all family members, people who are held inside of prisons and jails, and their adult and child family members outside, as well as a need to provide people who are incarcerated with adequate food, clothing, toiletries, other essential supplies, rather than expecting non-incarcerated family members to devote their scarce resources to cover their loved ones' basic needs. So the tendency not to think about, prepare for, or respond to the consequences for family relationships and family member well-being when making decisions about people being held in jails and prisons has been particularly acute during the COVID-19 pandemic. I wanted to draw people's attention here to the Lives on the Line report, which was created by the SE Justice Group and Color of Change. Full disclosure, I'm on the advisory board for the SE Justice Group, so I have a connection to their work and wanted to elevate and amplify it here. So from May 5th through June 7th of this year, SE and Color of Change sent out a survey through their networks, and they had 709 people who responded to questions about what challenges their incarcerated loved ones were facing with the pandemic, how family members were coping, and what resources people inside of institutions and on the outside did and did not have. And I very much want to urge everyone to read this report. I put the link there in the interest of time and because we want to give Keeonna plenty of time to speak. I'm not going to go into details, but I will conclude by saying that the survey findings and the other accounts that we are hearing through various sources about the enormous strains and stresses that the pandemic has placed on families of people who are incarcerated are at once devastating and completely unsurprising. Had we been working all along to follow the implications of the research in this field, and when the pandemic hit, had we been ready to act upon what is already well established, not only in the criminological and sociological and social work literature, but also in the realm of public health, the suffering that families have been experiencing this year could have been largely mitigated. So as I turn things over to Keeonna, I will just say that I would be very interested in the chat, which I know has been dynamic throughout the conference, and certainly in the Q&A to hear from people about ideas of how do we push evidence-based, forward in terms of policy and practice, and particularly interested in what people from other countries have seen be successful in this area. So with that, I'm going to close out the slides and turn things over to Keeonna.
Thank you, Megan. Can you guys hear me okay? Okay, so I just want to start out with just giving you a little a bit of background about myself and how I come to this work. My activism and my academic work is very personal to me, is personally informed. I have raised children with my ex-husband who was incarcerated for 20 years. I am a Pan America Writing for Justice Fellow. I'm also a PhD candidate in justice studies at Arizona State University. So my work is centered around Black women, motherhood, raising children with an incarcerated parent, and navigating the borderlands of the prison industrial complex. So in my actual presentation, I am going to address medical care, social distancing, cleanliness, food shortages, and emotional stress. Okay, so what's actually giving me hope over the last couple of months during this, you know, time of uncertainty is me seeing a fire has been ignited. And it's great to see organizations on the ground getting a lot of visibility with this movement to defund the police and having real conversations about abolition. Okay, but the relationships between COVID and prisons has created an alarming trend. So as Megan stated earlier, SE has done a wonderful job with, you know, getting this data out there. The data tells one story, but the stories of people who are in prison and living with the possibility of contracting and are being diagnosed with COVID for the most part are not being told. And COVID-19 in prison mirrors the outside world in more than one way. And so what we do know is that medical care is a great concern for incarcerated folks right now. People in prison already have lack of comprehensive medical care, but the medical staff was not equipped nor prepared for incarcerated folks to start contracting COVID. Okay, there were self-reported and documented higher instances of high-risk conditions among incarcerated folks, such as asthma, diabetes, and high blood pressure. And there's also been a high death rate of incarcerated folks that identify as Black. Okay, so we really need to start talking about how can people social distance inside of prison. Incarcerated folks already share a very small space, whether they are sharing a cell with one person, or they're living in a dorm setting, or in a gym because of overcrowding. And there's a lot of that still going on in California specifically. So we have to think about, how do we keep our loved ones safe? How can they sanitize? I'm not sure if you all remember how anxiety inducing it was when pandemic started for us on the outside world to get cleaning supplies and going into the store and seeing there's no tissue, there's no water, there's no sanitizer. So when you think about that, you have to think about what supplies are incarcerated folks getting. And the people that I am working with, that I do research with, that I collaborate with, they're reporting to me that they are trying to stay clean by mopping their floors every day and cleaning up with their toilet water. And that's also how they're washing their clothes. There have been no outside entities or staff that has been directly hired to ensure that cells and facilities are sanitized. There also is a mirroring of food shortage. As you know, when you go to the grocery store, prices have gone up for meat and produce. And deliveries coming in from different places that supply our food were lacking. So you could just imagine what incarcerated folks are eating, or folks that are directly depending on canteen because of dietary issues. And a lot of canteen has been stopped as well. So what we need to think about, what further harm that we're causing to incarcerated folks. Prison administrations, their response to COVID is to lock everyone down. So I personally believe that anyone who is in jail or prison or awaiting trial is now sentenced to a death sentence and being relegated to solitary confinement. Being locked down all the time, as we know, research has shown that it induces extreme anxiety, depression, and suicide. And in the SE report, it's been, you know, self-reported that people's loved ones are also having those same issues, and there's having those same issues. And that's not even speaking about people who already are diagnosed or have a history with mental health. So what we need to do at this point is really tap into the lifelines that have been cut. We're taking away incarcerated folks' emotional support. We're taking away their phone calls. We're taking away visits. And we're not even talking about the suffering and the great financial stress of people's loved ones who's been laid off or have scarce resources. So even if they want to accept a call or even if visitation was open, that's not an option any longer due to economic strain. So right now, if defunding the police and abolition was not at the forefront of society, COVID has shown us that we need to have a very real conversation about how inhumane prison is. And just like the outside world, COVID is amplifying existing problems and disparities that we have. And so what we want to think about is what can we do? And I personally think that we need to make sure that centers and researchers that have been collecting all of this great data and doing evidence-based research, we need to share that information with organizations that are on the ground, community organizers. We cannot solely make changes to policy with data alone, and we cannot make change with just storytelling, because policymakers will say, well, those are just isolated events. We need to both share the stories and the data together to enact real tangible change. And that is where I'm wrapping up at this point.
All right, thank you very much, Keeonna and Megan, for your presentations. And I'm just gonna turn off my timer now so it doesn't disturb us any further. Thanks to all our panelists for keeping to time. I was particularly struck by Keeonna's introductory remarks. I think the texture of the conversation does change, particularly for lifelong career academics, when you can put a face, a living, breathing human face to a number of these issues. They then go from just being mere statistics to you begin to see the consequences and lived realities of a number of these issues. I recall back in Boston, while I was a faculty member at UMass Boston, being at church in Cambridge, and an offering was raised for children of incarcerated parents. And they were all encouraged to come up on stage to be with the pastor. And I was just standing there, you know, just shocked that this is the toll. This is the consequence. These are the faces of individuals whose lives were being impacted. That was 8 years ago. I can only imagine what the scenario looks like in the constant and ever roaring prison industrial complex of the United States. But enough from me. My approach is generally a minimalist one in situations like this. We already have amazing questions. Our graduate assistant, Celine, has been doing an awesome job compiling the questions. So I'm just going to start from the very top of the list of questions. The first question here is from Michelle, and it's directed to Carla. And she says, it seems the community members are aware of these issues, and there is apparently some political response. How can we reduce the delay between noticing the problem and political action? The second question for Carla, just in case we run out of time, is from Kevin. And he says, Professor Shedd, important and disturbing talk. When I think of criminological applications of Foucault's carceral continuum, I think of Stan Cohen's classic book, Visions of Social Control. If you're aware of that book, I was wondering how you might characterize the major changes in the carceral continuum since that book was written in 1985. So Carla, you have a couple of minutes to do justice to those questions.
Thank you. Doing justice, that's the action. for our lives right now. And I really appreciate the other panelists and their presentations because it works so well. Whoever put this panel together, kudos, because I'm so excited sitting here and thinking, you know, just your comments now about the legacy of these systems and the children who are impacted, not just by being in the system themselves, but also their parents and relatives. And so to these questions directly, we have to sort of open up the responses where it isn't everyone working on a different response, but it's a concerted, interconnected effort. So you're right, Michelle. You know, the community knows what works and doesn't work. And that's why you have approaches by people like Pat Sharkey talking from the role of community organizations. You have people looking at the sorts of on the ground efforts in communities, Ruben Miller, you know, so there's an amazing crop of work going on, but we're not bringing it into the legal sphere necessarily because there are so many very like legal streamlined approaches. So my real force is how do we connect the institutions? How do we connect these aims and objectives? Is why I study schools, is why I study communities, and is why I study the sociology of the law. So, you know, I hope more projects can bring this approach to their own work and open it up and not hone into one thing. I think in criminology, that is one of the, you know, big critiques of just sort of winnowing our focus down to a snapshot, a variable, and we really have to open it up to the narratives, to the policies, and so much more. So really that's the push, and I think it's a push for the discipline and for those of us who do this work and care, actually care about the people in these systems. They're not just data points. And so the updates that Kevin mentions in terms of work on the carceral continuum, thank you for reminding me of that sort of classic book, you know, looking at Great Britain and sort of these larger visions. I'm going to go back to it as I put it in my chronology of thought and approaches to these issues. And I appreciate the refresher. And there have been so many more exciting works on misdemeanor courts and, you know, me kind of learning one complementary literature and now coming to this angle has been eye-opening. I hate that I'm on a pandemic sabbatical because I don't get to read as much as I want. And I actually got to run probably at the very end of this to go pick up children whose school is closing because of the pandemic. But what we have to do is really connect these things. And lastly, what Keeonna said is so important that people don't often care about the stories. And so like Du Bois, and to criminologists in particular, I would always try to have some numbers because people would get impressed. And it's why I was a mixed method researcher. I thought I can get their attention and then maybe I can make them care about the people behind these numbers. So that's been my approach. It shouldn't be on us to sort of open up eyes. It really should be for everyone to realize the deficits of just one particular hack and trying to deal with these multi-pronged, multi-level issues. So I appreciate the work of everyone on this panel and so many other speakers in this conference. And thank you for bringing us all together.
All right, thank you, Carla. The next questions are for Phil and Caitlin. And the first question comes from Nicholas. You focused on inter-organizational comparisons in your analysis, yet mentioned at the beginning the individual variable of PVS actors. Does this mean that these actors have negligible impact in the ways in which clients are intervened upon? The second question for you, Phil and Caitlin, is, remark there. The main question is wondering about the people who did not align with the mainstream script, in particular PVS organizations. For instance, are there variations in discourses between clients who had been through several PVS organizations in their life course and those who were first timers in the system?
Great, thank you. Perhaps if it's all right with Phil, I'll take the first question and then hand over the second to you. Thank you, Nicholas, to this great question. I'm so glad you asked it. We definitely don't mean to imply that PVS actors have negligible impact on the way that criminalized individuals are constructed as clients or, as you say, intervened upon. I've written elsewhere about the differences between different kinds of PVS actors. So I examined volunteers, paid staff, and then professional exes or wounded healers, so people with lived experience who then go on to work in this field, how they mobilize different assumptions about what helping is and what they're trying to accomplish there. And so I did find that, there is consequential differences in how specific actors approach that work. What we're trying to accomplish in this paper is to sort of bring another dimension that might matter. And that's like the sort of organizational discourses and the different kinds of programs that are being offered. So I think that both of these things, and I think Phil would agree, work together to impact how clients are being constructed and the work that's being done. It's very important to recognize both at the organizational level and within organizations, the specific actors and what they're trying to accomplish.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the second question, I believe from quarantine, is really excellent. And despite having the advantage of Katie answering the first, I still have not formulated a good answer to the second, other than I guess to say a few very fast things. One would be, I think that looking at misalignment or the variation in alignment would be really important and would probably benefit from a different methodological approach, right? And so one in which instead of perhaps conducting interviews, maybe a more ethnographic approach, for instance, or a different kind of interviews or a set of longitudinal interviews, working with people over a long period of time. So I think the fact that most people, the vast majority of people we interviewed, did align quite closely, right, with institutional and organizational logics, should not be taken as a kind of absence of a variation in an individual alignment, but just that these data are not particularly well suited to that. And I think they are therefore better suited to highlight, ideal types as in the title of the paper. So I suspect that's there. It's not as prominent in these interviews, but again, I think that's methodological, and I would really, there's some similarities in the two questions, which is, with luck, our goal anyway is that we are hopefully, raising a set of possibilities for future research. And I think that's just as looking very directly at the kind of triangle between organizations, PVS actors, and clients, which Katie was just speaking to, one could do a different set of research that really looked at that. The final thing, and to wrap up, I'll say is that, it is the case that we had a few instances, including the interview, one of the interviews that we spoke about, where people had been to, but by chance, really, multiple of the organizations. It wasn't common, but it did happen in a handful of instances. And in those instances, they aligned, as in our presentation, right? They aligned with their current organization. So that's a clue, but I think, again, we really need more empirical research to know a kind of more robust answer.
All right, thank you, Katie and Theo. One more question for both of you. This question comes from Nicole. I wonder how clients' views change from their initial contact with the organization to thereafter. That is, how much of their narratives came from the organization? I'm assuming that there was not a lot of personal choice involved in selecting the organization to be involved with after release.
Great. Thank you, Nicole. I'll say a few things, and maybe if Phil wants to continue, that'd be great. This is a really interesting question, this temporal element of sort of how people talk about their reentry. And admittedly, our data can't speak to that just because we only interviewed people at particular points in time, and we didn't have a lot of information about sort of their journey or where they had received other services. But I think that this is something that definitely needs to be investigated, both with clients of these organizations and also staff. So how people in both positions come to reach the sort of alignment between program goals and client experiences, I think is something that should definitely be pursued. And it would be really interesting to see sort of how long it takes people or to align with particular program goals. Yeah, just thank you for this question. That's definitely something that I think we'll take forward. And hopefully with a different methodological design, maybe we can hope to sort of approach.
Phil, do you want to add anything to that or not?
Perhaps only very quickly to say that indeed it would be really, really great to look at in more detail. And it's encouraging for that kind of line of inquiry and analysis that the people we interviewed themselves spoke, as Katie is suggesting, right? They spoke themselves of being on journeys, right? So they, I think there's every reason to investigate that, because indeed people talked about their own views of their presence and futures as having evolved, including through interfacing with the organizations from which we've recruited.
All right, thank you both. The next question is for Megan, and it comes from Kevin. You asked a question about how we might push for evidence-based change. In order to be pragmatically effective, how much do you think activists in the current moment have to strategically couch their justice-related claims in the neoliberal logical discourse of costs, cost-saving, personal responsibility, etc.? And the question for Keeonna from Michelle is, do you think the public and politicians are more receptive to narratives of defunding and abolition as a result of COVID, the sheer suffering perhaps waking people up?
I'll jump in very quickly because I know we're running short on time and I want Keeonna to be able to respond. I would just say briefly, I am always worried about taking a cost focus with this kind of work, because it is stunning repeatedly how we can then get into an argument about how much we should be spending on people's humanity and dignity. I think we do have substantial, you know, literature and research that can help say that it is more cost effective to invest in people's quality of life and, as I say, humanity. But going down that route can often get us into arguments I think we don't want to have. So I think really keeping the justice focus front and center is always important. Keeonna, I'll turn things over to you.
Thank you. I'm not sure if I would use the word receptive, but I definitely think COVID has opened the door for people to actually to reimagine what prison is. Me personally, I remember when COVID happened and I just kind of been watching people and listening to the news and things like that. And I feel like this is the first time that we, when I say we as a whole in society, have shared a collective mourning. And this is the first time that I think folks that are on the outside that may not do this work or may not have any loved ones, you know, behind the wall, feel a sense of loneliness and to be, and you know, you think about it, we're, you know, we're in houses and we have lights and we have, you know, we have working toilets and we have food, but to feel like you can't go anywhere, to not be able to reach out to your loved ones. And we have, you know, technology and phones and computers and all of these things, but people are realizing that's not enough. So I think this is the first time that people are really starting to think about what it's like for someone to be incarcerated. So I think COVID has been a definitely entry point to where we can, it's a jump off point that we can start this conversation.
All right, thank you, Megan and Keeonna. We have a question from Sandra, and it's directed to Phil and Caitlin. Could you say more about the place of gender stereotypes and what role they might have played in relation to the delivery of programming and perhaps the contrast drawn with men who are in programming?
Sure. Thank you for that question, Sandra. Gender is a really interesting lens to look at this, most especially because each of the four organizations position themselves as only offering services to men or women. So it became clear that there's this strong gendered element in how these organizations imagine reentry as unfolding, as having to be done in groups of men or women and not together. And at the same time, Phil and I were sort of surprised and curious about the fact that gender mattered or seemed to matter in ways that were less straightforward than we might have initially imagined. So certainly with women clients at Justice for Women, the priority was on emotional growth and things like that, contrast to some of the other organizations for men, which focused on improving material conditions. So like a lot about employment and things like that. And those fit into sort of fairly well-rehearsed arguments about gendered roles and things like that. But at the same time, there were things that mattered to the women that we talked to that didn't neatly fit into this gendered argument. So about how they found passion after prisons and like more often align themselves with becoming professional exes or wounded healers for this organization. And the same can be said about masculinity with the organizations for men is, there was so much variation amongst the male clients that it became difficult to sort of do a sweeping argument about how gender matters. But we do agree that certainly based on how the organizations are positioning themselves in the penal field and in relation to their clients, that gender is a significant element of how this whole process unfolds.
Okay, Phil, any thoughts on that?
I don't have anything to add other than such a special thank you to our panel.
All right. Now we have a question for Keeonna from Michael. And Michael says, damn, it's disheartening that we can't rely upon data alone, which I think is true, but why do you think that's true? I hope I conveyed the exact emotion of Michael in the word damn. Okay, so Keeonna.
I think for most people like myself, I'm a very visual person. And I think numbers alone are great, but when you just throw out and you just say, you know, 100 people are starving and people are just like, okay, that doesn't sound like that much. And, you know, and furthermore, they're saying, well, it's not me or anyone that I know. But when you can say there's 100 people that are starving and then you have 100 people come forth and say, this is how I'm living. This is how my children are living. I think that makes a more powerful impact. The people All right. need to be able to see it.
Thank you very much, Keeonna, for that very brief and succinct response. Thanks to all of our panelists for your amazing work. Thank you for what you do. We look forward to learning more about your work in the weeks and months to come. And I'd like to take this opportunity to invite everyone to our next panel, which is aptly titled Variations of Punishment. The lineup is truly extraordinary. Thank you very much, everyone. I look forward to connecting with you at one point or the other. Bye-bye.